Hello viewers, today we will discuss Saint Joan by George Bernard Shaw. Objectives: to understand the background of Shaw's Saint Joan and drama of ideas, to understand its plot and characterization, to examine the significance of the epilogue and prefaces. Summary: Saint Joan is a historical drama by George Bernard Shaw. It was written and performed in 1923. The play was based upon the life of Joan of Arc, a notable warrior who was born in Domremy in 1412. She fought for France but was burnt at the stakes for witchcraft and heresy in 1431. Her memory was revived after Charles VII came to the throne in 1456. And she was finally canonized in 1920. In his long literary career of 60 years, Shaw produced 60 complete works, 30 of which are considered major works. He stood second only to Shakespeare among the British playwrights. Some of his major works are Man and Superman, Caesar and Cleopatra, Saint Joan, Pygmalion, Arms and the Man. He is the only person to have been awarded both a Nobel and the Oscar for his work on the film Pygmalion. George Bernard Shaw had a fall while pruning trees and fractured his hip. Bedridden, he developed kidney failure and died on the 2nd of November 1950. Shaw's works are not noted for any special form or style. Their distinction lies in lucidity and clarity. In his life, Shaw was a tireless crusader for social rights and justice. He advocated the intellectual development of the people. He built up his own theatre, which is now known as the Theatre of Ideas. Shaw highly respected the importance of ideas and used ideas as the basis of dramatic conflict in his plays. He preferred to open up the minds of his audience rather than stirring them. Shaw was a literary critic, free thinker, and an advocate of the equality of income. Shaw's radical nationalism, his utter disregard of conventions, his keen interest in dialect and verbal wit often turned the stage into a forum for propagating ideas. He was also deeply interested in the different meanings and usage of words. Bernard Shaw has based the story of his play, Saint Joan, on the historical events that took place during the Hundred Years' War between France and England, in which the French army of Charles VII was defeated. At this juncture, a 17-year-old maid called Joan of Arc appeared and claimed that she had a divine vision to free France from England. She uplifted the spirits of all the people, from officers to the king, and brought considerable victory to the country. This enabled Charles VII to become the king of France. The play is a fine piece of dramatic craftsmanship. The events and characters in the play are used to foreground the themes of fundamentalism and justice. The final trial in the play is a culmination of the discourse on these themes in the play. Shaw has been widely acclaimed as the pioneer of the new drama in England, also known as the drama of ideas. Shawian drama primarily deals with ideas, using characters as spokespersons and dialogues and situations as tools for polemical discourse. He is not primarily a dramatist. His interest was in morals, politics, philosophy, and social reforms. He once wrote, "I write plays with the deliberate objective of converting the nation to my opinion. I have no other incentive in writing plays. Nearly all his writings address the social problems and evils of his time. In his works, Shaw examined themes like education, marriage, religion, government, healthcare, and even class privilege. He dealt with them with courage and determination. Man and Superman explores the theory of life force. Widowers' Houses is directed towards the atrocities of landlords in slums. In Arms and the Man, Shaw talks about the hollowness of romantic love. Getting Married embodies his criticism of the marriage system. Major Barbara is a criticism of capitalism as an economic system. Shaw's works belong to the drama of ideas, and the material of his plays is taken from the everyday life of modern times. Shaw has taken the story of the play from historical incidents surrounding Joan of Arc. Joan was born in the village of Domremy in the early years of the 15th century. While still in her teens, she claimed that she saw visions and heard voices telling her to set her country, France, free from the British. She was also said to have miraculous powers. She was commonly known as the Maid, and her fame soon spread all over the country. As the play opens, Joan approaches the captain, Baudricourt, a squire, who has no will of his own, and tells him that she has visions and hears voices from God. She inspires him with her self-confidence and undoubted faith and gets permission for her mission. As a result, she is sent to Dauphin, King Charles VII, the uncrowned king of France. She impresses the Dauphin, who is feeble in mind and body, and his courtiers, so he places his armies under her command. She becomes the head of the French army. She raises the siege of Orleans, inflicting defeat after defeat upon the enemy. She crowns the Dauphin as the King of France in the Cathedral of Reims. Her success earns her not only admiration, but also many enemies in and around England and France. She is captured by the English commander, the Earl of Warwick, who is hostile to her. Joan is put on trial for heresy, and the trial is dragged on for a year with the aim of killing Joan's spirit. Joan's repeated claims of visions and messages during the trial are not accepted by the church. The church considers itself the sole ambassador of God on earth, and so Joan is tried for heresy by the Holy Inquisition with Bishop Cauchon as the presiding judge. She is excommunicated and is handed over to the secular arm represented by the Earl of Warwick, and finally she is burnt at the stake. Joan of Arc, or the Maid. She is the female protagonist of the play. Based on the historical character of Joan of Arc, Shaw presents her as an unsophisticated girl with a gifted intelligence. Joan claims she has visions and hears the voice of God. She establishes her superiority in terms of military tactics and strategies, and leads France to magic victories that win the kingdom for Charles VII. Until her capture, her military strategy remains flawless. In every situation, right through the play, her integrity and her purity shine through all the hypocrisies of the other characters. The ill-meaning judges use intricate religious terms to corner her, but her simple common sense stupefies them. She is, however, inexperienced in the ways of the medieval society and ignorant of the jealousies of the feudal system. Her belief in the righteousness of her own conscience and her refusal to yield to the authority of the church inspires Shaw to refer to her as the first Protestant to be martyred by the Catholic Church. The Dauphin, later also called King Charles VII. He is portrayed as feeble in mind and body and indecisive in nature. He is a reluctant ruler and unconcerned about matters of the court. He is insolvent and in a pathetic state at the time of his meeting with Joan. In Shaw's play, he is almost forced by Joan into becoming a manlier person and occupying his royal position. He is later crowned as King Charles VII in the Reims Cathedral. He reinstated the memory of Joan in 1456. Dunois, or the Bastard of Orleans. He is a popular, young and efficient leader of the French forces who recognizes the value of Joan's military strategy. He is friendly to her, but his sincerity and patriotism are not consistent, and in the final battle in her trial in the court, he supports her excommunication, thus betraying her trust in him. The Earl of Warwick, he is portrayed as the symbol of feudalism. He is in charge of the English forces and is Joan's most bitter secular opponent. He fears Joan's demand that people's allegiance should only be to the king, and he fears that this will cut short his authority in the feudal system. He sees Joan's death as a way of retaining the status quo of the feudal system. As a pragmatic man, he is not only concerned with the church's condemnation or rehabilitation of Joan, he is also concerned about Joan's mission undercutting his authority as a feudal lord, and hence, in his view, she must be destroyed. John D. Stogumber, the Earl of Warwick's chaplain. At first, he is seen as a vicious and ferocious accuser of Joan. His reaction to her being a witch is a typical one for the medieval religious figures. He sees her in the most simplistic terms as a witch who should be burnt without delay. He fails to understand the more subtle arguments concerning Joan's threat to the church and to the aristocracy. However, the most dramatic change of the entire play occurs in the person of D'Stogumber. After he has witnessed the burning of the maid, he becomes a weak and broken man who spends the rest of his life trying to do good deeds for others in order to make up for his guilt for the vicious attack against the maid. Peter Cauchon, the academic theologian who represents the considered wisdom of the church. For him, Joan represents a direct threat to the historical power invested in the church, and he is proud that he has never asserted his own individuality and has always yielded to the opinion of the church. For Joan to assert her own private conscience, to rely upon her own judgments, and to commune directly with God without the intervention of the church is, to Cauchon, heresy in its highest forms. Like Joan, he is a person of principle, even if his principles serve the interest of the church and not of the individual conscience or imagination. Epilogue. Epilogues and prefaces are hallmarks of Shaw's writings. The argumentative nature of Shaw emerges in these two sections. An epilogue is not a part of the action. It is like an appended commentary to the action. The action of the epilogue takes place 25 years after Joan has been burnt. King Charles has a dream in which many of the characters appear again. These characters, including Joan, either explain their behavior in the play or relate some historical fact which Shaw realizes is important to understand the play. Shaw's pattern of giving historical information and explaining and summarizing characters' behaviors continues throughout the epilogue. The preface of the play. Shaw often writes a lengthy preface to his plays in which he comments on matters relevant to the play. The preface to Saint Joan is one of Shaw's longer ones and presents an objective account of Joan of Arc to the viewers. The preface is divided into 41 subsections, which could be loosely divided into the following categories for discussion. In the first section, Shaw lists various views of the historical character of Joan, Joan's misrepresentation in literature and in relation to the medieval society and the medieval church. The second section deals with the nature of Joan's death as an act of inhumanity as understood in modern times. The final section discusses how the historical drama of Saint Joan is viewed as a tragedy. Dear listeners, to understand Bernard Shaw's play Saint Joan, it is very essential to learn the history of France and England, especially the religious, political and geographical significance. At the time which the play depicts, France, like most other countries of Europe, was not a single united country. It was divided into a number of feudal estates, ruled over by powerful landlords or barons, showing only a nominal allegiance to the king, who had his capital in Paris. Burgundy was the most powerful of these feudal estates. Charles VI was the king just before the play opens, and his son, Dauphin, was the prospective heir to the throne. The English kings claimed large parts of France, especially the province of Normandy, as their own. Under their young and able King Henry V, they attacked France and defeated the French king, Charles VI, decisively in 1415. This is also known as the historic Battle of Agincourt. The Burgundians sided with the English as against their own king. Charles VI was compelled to a treaty in 1420, by which he disowned his own son, the Dauphin, as illegitimate, married off his infant daughter to Henry V and allowed the English to retain large parts of their conquest in France. The Dauphin had to leave Paris, and his forces were defeated by Henry in one battle after another. He found refuge at Chinon. In the play, he is shown holding his court at Chinon. The Dauphin was physically weak and inefficient. He was enervated by defeat and misfortune, and in the beginning, he was surrounded by selfish and unscrupulous advisers. But after 1426, a better and more efficient group of counselors and military generals came forward to his support. One of them was Dunois, the illegitimate son of the Duke of Orleans. In the play, he is referred to as the Bastard of Orleans. Now, let us look at some important literary and other terms used in the play. The first important term that we encounter in the play is the Holy Inquisition. This refers to a Roman Catholic organization in the past whose aim was to find and punish people who held and propagated religious beliefs that went against the Catholic Church. Another term that we find is Protestant. This refers to a member of the Christian Church that separated from the Roman Catholic Church in the 16th century. The chaplain is yet another term we find in the play. The chaplain is a priest or other religious minister responsible for the religious needs of a club, an army, a hospital, etc. Heresy. This is a term that refers to a belief that disagrees with the official principles of a particular religion. It could be any religion, Christian, Muslim, or otherwise. A heretic is one who follows heresy. Excommunicate. This means to punish someone by no longer allowing them to be a member of the Roman Catholic Church. Feudalism. This is a system which existed in the Middle Ages, in which people received land and protection from a lord when they worked or fought for him. Canonization. This is a process by which the Roman Catholic Church officially states that a dead person is a saint. Recantation. This indicates that publicly you are no longer a political or religious person of the type that you were before. Rehabilitation. This means to make people think that someone or something is good again after a period when people had a bad opinion of them. Dear viewers, with this we have come to the end of part 1 of our discussion of Saint Joan by George Bernard Shaw. In this lesson, we looked at a background of the author Bernard Shaw. We looked at some of the historical incidents that surrounded Joan of Arc and that formed the basis for this play. And we also looked at some important terms, literary and other terms that were found in this play. We hope that you enjoyed this lesson. See you again in the next class. Thank you.